Hey everybody, and welcome to my WWE Raw review for May 18th, 2015. Thank you for joining me here today on the review. If you didn't get a chance to check out my review of Payback 2015 from the other night, be sure to go ahead and check that one out if you get the opportunity to do so. And thanks for tuning in, though. Let's go ahead and get into Raw. Things kicked off with the Authority, as one should not be surprised. But they say that tonight is going to be an architect... like celebration, whatever the hell they called it, some type of a like celebratory you know, segment to present with Rollins with at the end of the night, because he is still the WWE World Heavyweight Champion. So basically the opening segment also unveils what looks to be a new championship, but it is just the Intercontinental title, and they talk about Elimination Chamber and the fact that there will be a vacant Intercontinental title Elimination Chamber match taking place. You get both Sheamus and Ryback involved in this opening segment, where Sheamus talks about the fact that, well, you know, I took out Daniel Bryan, who was Intercontinental Champion before, I might as well just be awarded the title for doing so, and Ryback saying that, coming out defending Daniel Bryan, and also saying that you might as well take on me here, because you're not the only one who wants the Intercontinental Championship. So Triple H makes it a match to kick off the night, Sheamus versus Ryback, and honestly, this is a feud slash match that I really wanted to see in the past. I said this, honestly, if I had a WrestleMania card to put together, I probably would have put these two guys in a feud, because I think Ryback is a really good babyface. He's over, has improved a lot, and even his mic skills have improved, and then Sheamus is just an unbelievable heel right now. So if you put those two together in a match, I think it's pretty good, and I think this opening contest was solid. You know, Sheamus doing the classic heel of, you know, feigning an injury and then hitting the brogue to get the victory. So honestly, a nice opening matchup here, in my honest opinion. And it did build up the Intercontinental Championship stuff as well for Elimination Chamber. So kind of killing a couple of birds with just a stone. So that was like a stupid way of saying a well-known saying, but you know me. So Sheamus beats Ryback in a enjoyable way to kick off the night, in my opinion. Then we get a backstage segment with Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins, the Authority. Ambrose saying that he wants not really a rematch, but he wants another shot at Seth Rollins one-on-one, because the last time they faced each other one-on-one, he beat him. He wants the title on the line, and instead gets a match with Bray Wyatt, of courtesy of Kane, who is acting all nice and happy for Seth Rollins, even though I think the ultimate thing here is we're going to end up getting Kane versus Rollins at some point in this future, I would imagine. But anyway, yeah, Dean Ambrose here just struck a chord with me, and that's why I tweeted out, you know, this is our everyman of this generation. This is the guy that's relatable, and, you know, just he is what everyone feels. I don't know, he just kind of expresses what the people are feeling, and because of that, he's always going to be a big deal, as far as I'm concerned. And he is, like, this generation's everyman, and that everyman type of gimmick is as good as it gets, if you ask me. So pretty cool. Just, I don't know, I kind of think that shined through in this segment here. Anyway, we get Neville and Barrett again, so a rematch from the pay-per-view. Barrett goes over here. Neville had an injured knee because of Bo Dallas, who had attacked him before his match, and then afterwards attacks him again. Maybe they're going to do Bo Dallas versus Neville. I mean, it's something for Dallas to do. They really have had zero with him, like, ever. So, I mean, Neville versus Bo Dallas could at least be a feud. I won't be surprised if this is one of those things that's not really a feud, just kind of, like, Bo Dallas attacks you 1 week, and then you beat him in a match the next week in 3 minutes, and then that's kind of that. But King Barrett gets a win. Yeah, clearly, you know, this was the same guy he walked away from the night before and then beats him in the middle of the ring. Go figure. So yeah, there's that. Anyway, we get the breakup tonight of Rusev and Lana in multiple segments. First off, one thing I gotta say is I don't really get why Rusev's being thrown into the Intercontinental Championship Chamber match. It's kind of weird. It's like, oh, well, you know, you lost 3 straight matches for the United States title, so we're just going to go ahead and give you an Intercontinental Championship shot. But I think it was more or less to continue to build the story between him and Lana. Basically, he came out and said, I only speak for myself. You know, Lana can't speak for me because she's the one who technically quit the match for him. And Lana, you know, saying that, oh, I've always been there for you. I've always supported you. I believe in you. I only did it because I thought it was what was best for you and for us. And then he says, there's no us, you're a piece of crap, you know, get the hell out of here, I'm done with you, you're disgusting. So she, as she was humiliated, walked away. Rusev being an excellent heel in this segment here, I loved it. I actually thought this was really well done and very, very good. So we get Bray Wyatt and Dean Ambrose next, and Wyatt goes over with Sister Abigail. J&J security caused some interference at the end. Honestly, this was a pretty good match. It's been like all the other matches between Dean Ambrose and Bray Wyatt. Pretty good. Again, Bray Wyatt goes over Dean Ambrose. At least this time there was a distraction and it made some sense because it relates back to the whole Seth Rollins thing in the first place. So at least it had a connection here this time. So I can handle the loss a little better in this situation because it wasn't just like a flat out, oh great, Wyatt, you know, beats Ambrose again. That proves nothing. Well, it did actually have a building block for the main event stuff. So that's not too bad. And Bray Wyatt does get a victory out of it too. So, and it was a pretty good match. I mean, I can't really complain too much. We've seen the match enough, no question about it. But it at least has been a few months, so, you know, I can digest it. It's not like it's a match that's happened 550 times. It's not that bad. It's just happened enough that it's like, man, I have seen this. But certainly isn't the type of match that you're like, oh god, I don't even want to watch this because I've seen it so much. Still was solid, and again, like I said, did at least build up to something, so not all bad. Then you get the Tag Team Championship rematch from the Payback pay-per-view, New Day and Kid and Cesaro going at it, but ends up in a disqualification when New Day, you know, they're double-teaming, I believe, Tyson Kidd in the corner with kicks, and the referee just had to throw the match out. And this ends up being a great build up for the tag team title match that'll take place at Elimination Chamber. You get the Lucha Dragons, Matadores, Ascension, Primetime Players all getting involved. This huge, crazy beatdown and brawl, and all these teams getting back and forth, and Primetime Players getting a chance to finally get in the ring and look strong. This was a really, really good way to me to build that up. I think the crowd was even getting this is awesome from this, and I don't blame them. It was awesome. It was a really cool way to build up the tag team title Elimination Chamber match. I really am looking forward to that. It's never been done. I'm interested to see how it's executed and how they play it out, and I think it'll be pretty cool. And this segment here was a really nice way to build that up. And the DQ finish for the tag title match, I don't have any issue with that because you get really cool build up for Elimination Chamber out of it. So to me, this was a nice and effective way to do that, especially when you only have 2 weeks to do so. Nice stuff, in my opinion. And definitely making the tag division feel better, even though a lot of these teams aren't featured on a good basis or aren't built up all that well and whatever, or don't really matter all that much. That's very true. But despite that fact, doesn't mean that this can't still be a really cool tag team title Elimination Chamber match, and that's really the thing to take away from it. So you've got the United States Open Challenge, which ends up turning into an amazing, a much more amazing segment with Kevin freaking Owens coming out to talk to John Cena, not to even have a match with him. Ends up getting powerbombed by Kevin Owens, and Owens absolutely owns the crap out of John Cena by saying when Cena is about to give him a veteran piece of advice, and he says, I don't need any pieces of advice. I've been in this business longer than you have. I just didn't get my break till now. Like, this is the essence of how you feature an NXT star, your NXT world champ. This is how it's the essence of how you feature this guy on main programming, and the essence of how you make him feel like a badass. Kevin Owens not only has been built really well on NXT, but this was a great way to feature him here on Raw, and him and Cena are going to face each other at Elimination Chamber, and that just makes you look that much more forward to Elimination Chamber. So they're really stacking things up here. You've got the great NXT special to look forward to here on Wednesday, and then you know, the May 31st Elimination Chamber show has the potential to be very, very good. So, I mean, honestly, this was the segment of the night for me. He powerbombs Cena and then steps on the United States title. I mean, this guy knows how to play a heel extremely well. And he's also really good on the microphone, if you couldn't already tell. His tweets are, like, A-plus worthy. All the stuff that he is able to do is just something else, as far as I'm concerned. It's just amazing. I personally think that Kevin Owens has the potential to be, like, a top heel going forward. I mean, he's 31 already, but, you know, I think his transition to the main roster is a snap of your fingers. This guy has a ton of experience. It's not like he's just some newbie off the street who's been in the business for 2 years. This is a guy who's been around for a long, long time, knows a lot of things, and the fact that they kind of blended that into this promo just made it that much more awesome. And forget the damn match. This promo and segment was freaking amazing. It was as good as you could ever ask for. So I absolutely love that part of the night. Amazing. So we get Dolph Ziggler versus Stardust, and this is just really a fucking job match, filler bullshit. Ziggler goes over. Stardust still irrelevant. Yay. But you get more build up with Rusev here. Lana comes out, ends up kissing Ziggler twice. And then Rusev obviously comes out very angry, and Ziggler was announced to be the final participant in the Intercontinental Championship Elimination Chamber match, which Rusev is a part of, and again, like I said, I don't know why, but this is what they're going with. So Rusev ends up beating the crap out of Ziggler for a minute, then yells at Lana, but while he's yelling at Lana, gets zigzagged from behind, and then Lana and Ziggler walk away with Rusev pissed off in the ring. So now you've got Lana full-fledged babyface. I'm not saying she's going to be the valet for Dolph Ziggler on a regular basis, and I don't really think that needs to happen at all, but still, it's basically to build up the frustration level for Rusev. And if it is a valet for Dolph Ziggler, I don't think it would be completely bad. It could have some potential, but I think her on her own is probably the best thing to go with this. But again, let's let it play out and see where it goes. Honestly, this segment was pretty good. It was kind of, like, random. It is random to have Dolph Ziggler be with Lana all of a sudden and, you know, whatnot. But, you know, we can maybe get Ziggler and Rusev as a feud. It might be a nice transition into a new feud for Rusev after the Cena one. So I think it could actually be a nice way of doing that. It is kind of random, but it still ended up working out to me in a pretty effective way and was a nice segment to follow up what was previously a really good heel segment on the part of Rusev. So overall, a pretty good night as far as the whole Rusev-Lana thing goes, and that story develops. So, and some nice build-up to Elimination Chamber in between, so good stuff. Next, you get Eric Rowan and Luke Harper defeating Fandango and Zack Ryder in tag action. Complete filler. I don't have anything to say about this. It was what it was. Filler, didn't matter. They're trying to make Rowan and Harper look strong against two of the biggest jobbers in the company. So, doesn't really do much. So we get the Divas Championship next. Nikki Bella and Naomi. Stephanie tells that Brie Bella that she's going to be put into some therapy sessions because of all the stuff that she's dealing with the fact that Daniel Bryan is injured and stuff. So thus making the advantage go to Naomi, since Tamina is at ringside with her. But the match ends up in a disqualification because Tamina super kicks Nikki in the face when it looks like she's about to beat Naomi once and for all. And then after that, Paige ends up returning and attacking every damn buddy and saying that this is her house. So, I have no real issue here with the Paige return, but I would have done this segment quite differently. I would not have had Tamina super kick Nikki in the face here like that. It doesn't make any sense if you want this is a championship match. If it was just one-on-one contest, I'd understand this DQ finish. This is where the DQ finish is just like, why? It's a title match. Why would your friend Tamina super kick Nikki in the face? If I was Naomi, I'd be pissed off. I just lost a shot, any shot I had at the title. I know she was about to hit her finish, but who says Naomi couldn't have reversed out of it? Or why couldn't Tamina have come up onto the apron and caused a distraction, which thus could have led to Nikki Bella's attention being refocused and then thus allowing Naomi to reverse it? Simple stuff, you know? It's like, really, there is an easy way around just going into the ring and super kicking her right in the face, thus causing your friend, the person you're trying to help win the title, not even win the title at all. So I don't understand why you wouldn't be pissed, because I certainly would be if I was her. Moving on with the whole Paige thing, I think what they could have done is had Naomi about to win the match when Paige returns, causes the distraction, thus helping Nikki get the victory. And you still could have had Paige take every damn buddy out. That doesn't matter to me. But I still think you could have had it be to build up the fact that Paige is costing Naomi the championship, and that makes a ton of sense because Paige lost her title match against Nikki in the first place because of Naomi. So I think that would have made more sense overall. Again, I'm not trying to be too nitpicky here, but I think that all of those things this entire thing could have been done a ton better. So to me, it was a letdown, because I think it could have been booked a lot better. Anyway, there's no way to get perfection. That's just my opinion. That, to me, that would have been more effective, but that's just how I see it. So anyway, then you get the announcement of Cena versus Owens. Really looking forward to that. And then the main event segment. Seth has his appreciation, video package put together and everything, celebration, whatnot, and then in comes Dean Ambrose, and we get a brawl, and that leads to Dean almost destroying Seth Rollins through some cement bricks, as Rollins did to him last year, and then the authority says, wait, we will give you your match. So basically, Ambrose was saying, hey, until I get my WWE Championship match, I'm going to do whatever the hell I've got to do. And he says, hey, if you ain't going to give it to me, then I'm going to smash his head. And then they're like, no, don't do that. We'll give you your title match. So Dean Ambrose will officially be facing Seth Rollins one-on-one for the title. And Dean Ambrose looks strong to finish the night. So very interesting to me. I am very interested by that. So... yeah, he didn't look strong to finish the night, excuse me. Seth Rollins ended up still ending strong by hitting the pedigree. So Seth Rollins ends up getting over ultimately, but Dean Ambrose still gets what he wants, which is the championship match. So it was a fine way to finish off Raw, in my opinion. It was okay to not really have a main event match. We usually get a main event match, which is a tag team match, or one guy who's going to face another guy at a pay-per-view versus the other guy from the other feud. That kind of, we see that stuff all the time. It was actually kind of refreshing to see something like this instead. And then it still builds up to a match for the world title. So you're still, hitting the nail on the head in terms of getting down what you want to get for your main feud, but at the exact same time, you're not giving us just that 8-minute match that really doesn't, it's like, whatever, it doesn't really do much. So to me, this segment was fine. Rollins using the pedigree, well, if it's not the curb stomp, it's the pedigree. I mean, the only thing that I don't like is that it doesn't make him stick out, because every guy having their own finishing maneuver always makes them stick out more, and obviously the curb stomp made Rollins especially stick out almost over anybody else. So for him to use the pedigree at this point in time isn't so bad, because he's already had a move that has made him stick out, but you still want him to continue to have that as time goes on. But him using the pedigree is also kind of a showing of the fact that he is, getting that torch handed down to him from Triple H or whatnot, or that, he is Triple H's guy. It like signifies it in one move. So in another way, it's kind of fucking awesome. So I can't really sit there and be like, oh, this is so stupid, because it's not stupid. As long as he hits it right, the one at Payback wasn't so good. But the one here on Ambrose was fine. A hell of a lot better than the one from the night before. But either way, I think this has potential to be an amazing WWE Heavyweight Championship match between Ambrose and Rollins. I got zero issues with it. Like I said before, I understand that, Ambrose wasn't built up progressively to the main event. But, the guy's amazing. He deserves to be there. At least they're putting a good, awesome talent in the main event. I mean, yeah, sure, I agree that everybody deserves to get built up. In some way or another, whether it's a progressive build-up or whether it's a quick but effective build-up, the Brock Lesnar type of build, but I don't really have much to complain about, because I know the match is going to be awesome, I know I'm going to enjoy the crap out of it, so, there might be some nitpicky things to say about the progression of build, but you can't really sit there and also at the same time be like, oh, you know what though, it sucks in that match, who fucking cares, just because the build wasn't perfect for Ambrose. Like, no, it doesn't matter. The match is going to be awesome, and it definitely is two guys who are both main event ready. There's no question about that. So, at the end of the day, I'm going to just praise it and say, good, at least they're doing something that's really good. No Randy Orton, no Roman Reigns on this edition of Raw. I guess Roman Reigns is returning to SmackDown this Thursday. I'm not sure where they're going to go with those two guys from here. I guess we'll be interested to see what does take place for both guys. I'm not really sure. But overall, I thought this Raw was actually pretty damn enjoyable. Had a concurrent storyline throughout the night of building Elimination Chamber up, building NXT with Kevin Owens, having an amazing promo between him and John Cena, a good opener between Sheamus and Ryback, building the Intercontinental Championship and tag stuff in both effective ways, Wyatt and Ambrose having an enjoyable match, a good way to finish off the night to build up to a WWE title match. Really good stuff between Rusev and Lana tonight as well. I mean, honestly, this was a pretty damn enjoyable Raw. I think it deserves a B. B minus, no question. I don't see why it would deserve anything less. This was one of the better Raws of the year. I mean, the couple weeks ago and this one are probably the two best Raws from this year. I mean, maybe not, but two of the best Raws from this year, no question about it. This was a much more enjoyable show tonight, and so that's a great thing. That's a great thing, and I'm really glad. I want to enjoy Raw every week, so it's good to be, you know, throwing a B at it. I think a solid straight B is fine. I won't say nothing that blew me away, but nothing was like, there weren't a ton of amazing things, but there were a few things that were really, really good, and a couple of things to me that were greatness, and I think what did blow me away was the Kevin Owens segment. That absolutely did. I wouldn't say anything else blew me away, but it definitely had me at like, oh, that's really good, oh, that's nice, that was good stuff, you know, and that's good. That's all you need. It wasn't just solid, it was good stuff. So that's always a really nice thing to see, is when you're watching the product and you say to yourself, I really like that. That was cool. Nice. And then with the Kevin Owens thing, you're just marking the fuck out. So flat out, good stuff here on Raw. A B show, no question about it. And honestly, if there was a couple more things that were just executed a bit better, it might have been in A territory. It really might have been. But I think B is a fair grade here for this edition of Raw. And it's always harder to give the show a higher rating when it comes to like an A rating, because of the fact that the 3 hours, there's always a couple segments that are going to be like filler or eh or draggy, whatever. There's always going to be a couple of things that just aren't, you know, on point. If the show was 2 hours, this was just a 2-hour show and you cut out some of the filler stuff, I almost guarantee you it would have been an A- Raw, but whatever, it doesn't really matter. It's not really all that important what my grade is for Raw. I think a straight B is really a good show. Anything that's, you know, in the B range or better is always going to be a good show. You know, and the C range is just, you know, middle of the road. It had some moments, whatever. And anything below the C minus is, you know, pretty crappy territory. But to me, this was a good Raw, and that's that for the review. So thanks for watching, guys. I really appreciate it. Be sure to give me a like if you enjoyed. Comment your thoughts on Raw, of course. And do check out my Payback review if you get the chance. And, of course, subscribe if you haven't yet. Thanks for tuning in. Really appreciate it. And I will be back with an NBA playoff predictions video for the Eastern and Western Conference Finals, as well as a recap of Round 2 before the games begin on Tuesday evening. So be sure to check that out. And I'll be reviewing the NXT Live special show Wednesday, and then hopefully an Impact review for Friday and the Q&A over the weekend. So I'm, you know, really hoping to have a nice busy week here on the channel and give you guys plenty of content. So thanks for watching. Till next time, you guys have yourselves a great day, and peace out.